Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome you to the board meeting, the November board meeting of the OPPD. My name is Mick Mines. I serve as chairman this year. As you can tell from my voice, I have very little left, and I just had surgery, and I'm running on fumes. I've asked Director Green, who is our treasurer, to assume the chairmanship. Don't take over the chairmanship. You just act in my behalf
today. I'm your ventriloquist dummy.
I appreciate you coming, and Director Green.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good afternoon, and welcome to the November board meeting of Omaha Public Power District. This is an open meeting. The agenda has been posted, and if you want to speak on a specific item, you can go to the microphones on the, well, that would be stage right for me. Stage, that would be your left, and address the board. But it has to be germane to that particular topic. If you want to talk about general things or things that aren't on the board agenda, we'll give you an opportunity at the end to address the board and speak about those things. Please make your comments within the guidelines that we have posted on the OPPD website. Try to keep them about 3 minutes. There's a timer over there. They keep track of you, and you'd be surprised how much you can say in 3 minutes. And they used to tell me that the no souls are saved after the first 10 minutes. Well, yours is down to 3 minutes. At this time, I'd like to call on the president of the organization to give us a safety brief.
Great, thank you, Director Green. There are several exits to this room. In the event of emergency, we would ask the group here to kind of be split in the middle, and this group to my right, to the left of the auditorium, would exit out to the back right doors, and this group would exit out to the back left doors. In the event we need to actually leave the building, we would exit on the 16th Street side across from the Orpheum. And as we would migrate the steps, we would ask you to use our three-point touch, which would be one hand on the railing and 2 feet on the ground. Fire extinguishers are at the rear. If you go out the rear door, conference room A is right across the hallway there. It's right around the corner. We do have other fire extinguishers in the kitchenette and the cafeteria area. If you have a medical condition, please write it down or tell your neighbor. The first aid kit and the AED is actually on the brick wall in our cafeteria, facing on the outside of the cafeteria. It's on the right-hand side, one on top of each other. Is anybody here in the auditorium certified or trained in the use of an AED or in CPR? So obviously we have some that are, several that are trained. In case of the event of a fire, please don't use the elevators. If you need assistance migrating the steps or the exits, please let one of the OPPD staff know, and we will help you do that. In case of an emergency, I'll ask Mr. Rod Rogers in the back, who's a manager of our security and our facilities group, to call 911. And the event of a tornado, even though we don't anticipate any today or severe weather, we would actually move to and direct you to a safe area of the building for that kind of an event. And so with that, Director Green, that is our safety briefing. Thank you.
Thank you. This time we have an announcement regarding public notice of meeting.
Notice of the time and place of this meeting was publicized by notifying the area news media, by publicizing same in Omaha World Herald and outlets, by displaying such notice on the arcade level of Energy Plaza since November 8, 2016, and by mailing such notice to each of the district's directors on that same date. A copy of the proposed agenda for this meeting has been maintained on a current basis and is readily available for public inspection in the office of the district's corporate secretary. Additionally, a copy of the open meetings law is available for inspection in the public meeting book located in this meeting room. Agenda item number 4, approval of the September 2016 Comprehensive Financial and Operating Report, the October 13, 2016 board meeting minutes, and the November 17, 2016 agenda.
Need a motion?
So moved.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
Hurley?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion carried. Agenda item number 5, resolution number 6147. Now therefore be it resolved that the Board of Directors, 1, accepts the monitoring report for SD6 safety in the form as set forth on Exhibit A attached hereto and made a part hereof, and finds OPPD to be sufficiently in compliance with the policy as stated, and 2, approves the recommended revisions to Board Policy SD6 safety in the form as set forth on Exhibit B attached hereto, effective November 17, 2016.
So moved.
Mr. Hurley, I believe this is your item.
Okay, we're going to vote on this item. It had to do with the SD6 safety monitoring report that we heard a presentation from Kevin on this morning. So we're just going to call for a vote, and I will so move.
Second. I sort of want to point out.
We draw votes so we don't have to have a vote on it. They're done. Roll call, please. Well, first, anybody want to talk about the changes in the monitoring report for safety requirements? They appear to be rather minimal, more updating and correcting a couple typographical errors in the system.
I think it should be mentioned that our safety performance is the best it's ever been almost in the history of OPPD this year as far as meeting our metrics that we have set aside.
Safety at the nuclear power plant, as it's being shut down and put in the same operating conditions and decommissioning, so we're more often injuries, there were in first aid calls. Let's put that in as part of this. So unless somebody has some questions, we'll call for order.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh? Gay? Oh, sorry. Green?
Yes.
Hurley?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion carried. Agenda item number 6, resolution number 6148. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that, 1, the engineer's certificate requesting that the board waive the sealed bid requirements in accordance with Nebraska Revised Statutes section 70-637 through 70-639 is hereby approved. 2, management is hereby authorized and directed to negotiate and enter into a contract with PW Power Systems, Inc. for the repair work and replacement parts for the Sarpy County Station Unit B engine, subject to review and approval of the final contract documents by the district's general counsel. And 3, the notice required by Nebraska Statute 70-637 shall be published in the Omaha World Herald.
I so move.
Second. Mr. Ulrich.
Green. As you know, Sarpy County Station has several peaking units, of which Station Unit 4B was inspected this fall. We typically do these inspections in the fall, so repairs are needed. The unit will be up and running by the time the peak season hits next summer. 4B was found to need some repairs, and I'm going to ask John Hansen to describe the repairs needed and explain the process to us.
Thank you, Director Ulrich. I'd ask Ms. Tracy to for the slides. Oh, okay. So as Director Ulrich mentioned, in September we did inspection of the 4 Bravo engine. These are Pratt & Whitney engines, were installed in year 2000. And okay. I feel like I got the surf going on around me or something.
Ignore the man behind the curtain.
Yeah. Okay. So we did find some damage when we did the boroscope. What the boroscope does is it allows us to inspect the internals of the engine. And we found that some coating had chipped away, as well as what we call a J seal that seals some of the air inlet from the combustion chambers. The J seal is a fairly good sized piece of metal,
that if it is fully liberated, it could pass through the rotating parts of the engine and may have already to some extent, and will cause further damage. So we did put a moratorium on operation of that unit when we found that. Some of those parts had moved, and what we're asking for is the ability to negotiate and award a contract to Pratt & Whitney Power Systems for the repair of that engine. Pratt & Whitney is the sole proprietary source of that. We have gone out on occasion in the past to try to find other vendors, but to date they are the singular repair shop for that. We estimate the repair costs in the amount of at or near $1.7 million. And as Director Ulrich mentioned, the plan is to have it ready for next year's peaking system, peaking season. Thank you. Just a little distraction.
Just a little?
Well done.
Thanks.
Any further questions?
What'd you say?
Hey, yeah. It was you, John.
Let me go back to the beginning there.
Okay, who complained about not hearing?
It would be him, Mark.
Come down close.
Would it be acceptable to
give it a shot?
Give it a shot.
Thanks, Andrew.
Well, that's being done, we can at least vote on this item. Any public comments on fixing the unit at South Omaha 26th?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh? Green?
Yes.
Hurley?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion carried. Agenda item number 7, should I wait?
It also reports on the power.
What do you think about the election?
How about those blue jays? Yeah. No, this isn't public comment. It's separate.
Mm-hmm.
Wait for Andrew to give us the
thumbs up here.
Are you still getting
moves? It's all super moves.
I think we've lost half of the 6 people who watch us. Probably be a good time to tell the joke about when the IT person tells you to turn off the car, get out, close the doors, open the doors again, get back in and start the car. We're rebooting. It's all that needs to be done.
You realize that's not a car on your own.
Yeah, before it sounds.
Oh.
I thought it was driverless.
Maybe so, fixed here.
You can't get them though. But I got the satellite.
We good to go?
We're ready?
Okay. Agenda item number 7, resolution number 6149, therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors that it accepts the monitoring report for strategic directive SD10 ethics in the form as set forth on Exhibit A attached hereto and made a part thereof and finds OPPD to be sufficiently in compliance with the policy as stated.
Require. Oh, first we need a motion.
So move.
Second.
Second.
I know that voice. Okay.
Must be for me.
That's for you. Please, go ahead.
Okay. Policy SD10 ethics was introduced and discussed in detail today. And what it does is that it requires high ethical standards in all aspects of official conducts for both our employees and the Board of Directors. And I think what the main change that we did to this is that we did add the OPPD employees to this strategic directive. We went through with it. We require high ethical standards in all aspects of official conduct, such as loyalty, compliance of applicable laws, observance of ethical standards. I'll just go through it. Things. And then we also established clear guidelines for conflicts of interest, improper conduct and activities, compensation for non-company sources, personal use of company assets, corporate opportunities, gifts, business courtesies, confidentiality, and compliance. All this was discussed today. And there was then again, we have a require a disclosure and reporting of any potential conflicts of interest, either of the employees or the Board of Directors. And we also provide a process for reporting suspected violations and investigating suspected violations of the code and policies. And as we had today, providing an annual report to the board. So our recommendation is to accept this monitoring report. And the one change again was just to add employees to the SD10, the ethics policy.
Any questions or comments from the board? Any questions or comments from the general public? Seeing none. You have to come down to the microphone and speak. And for the record, you're going to have to tell us your name and address.
Sure, no problem. My name is Ray Rose, 4313 Saratoga Street. Back to your board of ethics and so forth. Mm-hmm. How are your measurements being measured, far as in reporting wise and basically how are these measured? How are your ethic board measuring your productivity and so forth?
Okay.
Mark. Question.
Thank you for your question, Chairman Green, today. We don't have measurements specifically for productivity in this particular code of conduct. It really is more around the ethical standards of the board. And so it specifically addresses what constitute violations under that code and what constitute conflicts of interest and provides a process for reporting those. And we have had none reported in the last 12 months.
Now, is this just internal, as in your employees or customer-based or
We have vendors? A code of conduct for our employees as well, and we have an ethics oversight committee within the company that monitors that.
All right, and how are those being measured for your customer owners-wise? I know you have a survey that you put out every year. I know that's one measurement. How else are you?
So we have a conflict of interest questionnaire that we send out annually, and we have people let us know what potential conflicts are. We investigate all of those. We have a hotline that people can report ethics issues through. And as I mentioned, the Ethics Oversight Committee monitors those. We investigate every allegation that we get, and then we report those back to senior management.
So is there a certain department that investigates the ethics?
It depends on what the issue is. Anything that's HR-related, human resources takes a look at. Anything that's financial, safety-related, those types of things the audit group looks at.
Plus, they're reviewed by our auditors and reported to the audit committee of the board of directors.
All right, my questions are in particular for the customer owner. You know, I know you guys have your ethics as far as your compliances or whatnot, but far as in who is overseeing looking at the board's decisions that are affecting customer owners, as myself.
This has nothing to do with this ethics.
This is an ethics thing.
As far as in your business and how you're conducting and so forth, correct?
The oversight of the customer owner by the customer owner is called an election. And in terms of productivity, whether it's a good board member or not a good board member, every 6 years, the customer owners in that district get a chance to make the determination on that. This is strictly towards the board of directors and the ethical requirements that we expect of each other. And we present that in a public document to the public so that they know we're serious about this.
I think your question, while not pertinent to this particular agenda item, you might ask that at the end of the meeting.
Very well.
And we can talk about that.
Very well. Thank you, Ms., for your time.
Jeffrey Picorni, 4969 South 149 Court, Omaha. Director Green mentioned, I'm not directing the question to him, but he mentioned a document on the ethics just in the last couple minutes.
That's what we're voting on.
The policy.
And that document will be where in this whole situation? Was it presented in the agenda?
The resolution which we're approving.
Was the resolution presented somewhere in the agenda or the?
Yes, it's on the agenda.
Okay.
It's on the website.
It's more than three sentences, though, right?
It wants to see
the policy will be online, correct?
It's a policy that's actually online. We have 15 SD policies.
Okay. It's not in the agenda or the paperwork that was presented today, then.
What's your question?
No, I want to read it. And I wonder where it is.
It's online.
And do you have the policy of having things you're voting on present at the meeting?
Yes, that's a legal requirement.
That's what I thought it was.
And the book's right there. You can.
It's right here.
Is that piece of paper here right now?
Yes.
Can I look at it?
I showed it to you.
Thank you. Ms. Tracy will let you use the one that she.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Vote, please.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
Hurley?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion carried. Agenda item number 8, resolution number 6150. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that the appointment of Martha L. Sedke as Vice President of Human Capital and Assistant Secretary of the District and the compensation and benefits as set forth on the attached exhibits be and are hereby approved, effective December 4, 2016.
So move.
Second.
Ms. McGuire.
It's been discussed as the role of Martha Sedke in the past year and a half, 2 years, has gone way beyond just a human resources position. And Mr. Burke has suggested that we change her role in to be Vice President of Human Capital. And I'm going to turn this over to to President Burke to discuss exactly what human capital is and her, really the role has already expanded, and I think everybody has known that she's far beyond right now human resources, but I think you even have bigger vision. I wonder if you could explain that
to
everyone.
Sure, I think, thank you, Director McGuire. The conversation that we've had with the governance committee is around this increasing role that HR plays across all of our organization, from not just hiring and benefits and those pieces, even those are pretty important pieces in the organization, but it's really about how we look at the future and as we transform our business, how the human capital component, our employees and relationships with our employees and our organization structure, the training and development, our leadership framework, all of those critical components kind of align based on the direction of the organization. And so my recommendation today is to have Mart Sedke be the Vice President of Human Capital, really. One, because she's been operating at that executive level as a direct report to me for the last year and a half or so, and has been performing at a significant high level and is part of the senior team strategy development and execution and works across the whole organization, not just from a recommendation piece where other parts of the organization would be required to implement it, but truly engaging and integrating the HR organization in the operations of the company. And so with that, I thought it was appropriate today to make that recommendation as a vice president of human capital. That would report directly to me and certainly assume those executive responsibilities and officer responsibilities across the organization. I will add that Mart currently leads our division manager and direct report group organizationally as well, but also is the executive sponsor for our Best Places to Work strategy, which is to really create an environment as we kind of move through this energy transformation that really drives people to come work for OPPD, drives people to stay at OPPD, and make sure that the work environment is appropriate across all of our groups of employees, whether it be the executive or management or exempt or labor relations related activities. The comments I made to the board earlier today was really around her proactive outreach with our collective bargaining units, but also our very proactive outreach across our whole leadership team across the organization. And it appears to be the right time to truly raise that part of the organization up to the executive level. I have had that conversation with our senior team members and we're fully aligned, certainly to support it from an executive piece to do that. So with that, Director McGuire, I'll pass it back to you.
Thank you very much. The proposed salary would be $275,000. Her present salary is $250,000. As far as the 50% midpoint, in relation to that, she is now at 85.9% of the 50% midpoint. If there's any other discussion?
And this is considered a promotion.
Considered a promotion.
By all appearances, Mart's been doing the job. It's time to get her the recognition of what she's been doing.
Any other questions from the board or comments?
I had the opportunity to ride with Mart out to the wind farm out in northwest Nebraska, and we. You want to get to know somebody a little better, ride with them in a car for about 4 hours.
It's more like 8 hours, I think. It was 4 hours each way.
I felt like I knew her a lot better, and I actually visited a lot about what she's been doing. And to me, it's just, this is a no-brainer. She's obviously doing the job and doing it well.
I have one comment about Mart, is I think she does an incredible job with the technical side of human capital and also the human side of human capital. And sometimes you don't get both mixes, and I think Mart's a perfect mix.
Yeah. And her actions and role with the Fort Calhoun closure and her dealing, she was up there I don't know how many times up to Fort Calhoun. I've never seen an HR person go that often to Fort Calhoun, and she really knows the employees up there. She listens, and she'll continue to listen. She's done a great job there.
Any comment from the people attending?
Jeffrey Picorni again. I don't know how many appointments I've seen in my 20 years of attending meetings, but at least 5, maybe 10. And they're done in secrecy. On the agenda, the name of the person wasn't even placed on the agenda, which is par for the course. I always ask the board, and different members have been here in the past, why not at least tell us who you're appointing and give them the salary? But then to be excluded from the meeting today, the committee meeting, where you talked about this person, antenna always go up and say, gee, there's something wrong with this person. And they don't want to expose the public to this person's faults or whatever. And she might have a record or whatever. And the glowing comments
Mr.
from
McCorny,
the-
Mr. McCorny, she was on the agenda, and I think Mrs. Tracy can explain that to you. She is on the agenda.
Well, I was going to let him finish first.
The glowing comments from the board, and this has happened, Mr. Easterlin, for one I can remember, that was current a couple years ago. But through the years, the glowing comments from the board should not be in conflict with the closed situation, with going into the closed meeting, without mentioning the person's name. I mean, she sounds like a perfect person for the job. And Mr. Mines, Mr. Hurley, why the secrecy? And secrecy and non-transparency will only get you in trouble. I've seen it through the years, different boards, different governing officials. In particular, this case, it always seems to get more exaggerated, too. Gee whiz, you should have talked to us about it. You should have given her name. She should have been in the World Herald a couple weeks ago. We're going to promote this wonderful woman. I can't understand the philosophy. Different people on the board now. This happened. Mr. Easterlin had a different group. And 10 years ago, there was a different group. Why the secrecy? Why the non-transparency? That's my question. And
thank you for your comments.
Okay. It doesn't seem to do any good, but maybe one day on the agenda, the person's name, salary, and their attributes will be there for us to come down and say, yeah.
Well, you don't get a second comment. just briefly, if I may, if you look at your board agendas for today, under item 8, the resolution, the name of the soon-to-be Vice President of Human Capital and Assistant Secretary is named. The earlier thing that Mr. Picorni is talking about is the right of the board of directors in a committee or even at a board meeting to go into executive session to discuss personnel matters. And it's set out in the statute on the open meetings law, and that particular provision of the open meetings law has not changed in 30 or 35 years. So this is just the standard procedure when you're dealing with personnel matters. But when it comes time to appointing an officer of the board has the responsibility to go forward and do that in a public meeting, in a public fashion, and that's what the resolution is before us. Anyone else? Vote, please.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
Hurley?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion carried.
The next item is the state of the utility. Mr. Burke?
Great. Thank you, Director Green. And I'll kind of go through this. I know we have some pretty important presentations that'll be following, so I'll kind of step through it as quickly as possible. And
we're having some technical difficulties today.
I understand that, so I'm going to continue to move forward. I'm going to start from our generation side and work to our community roles and some of the activities that we've been doing. But I'll let you know our Nebraska City 1 remained in service through the entire month of October, and it's been in service for 109 consecutive days, capacity factor of about 90%. Nebraska City 2 remained in service for the entire month of October and has been in continuous service for 111 days at over 90% capacity factor. Our lean fossil activity continues with our operations on our generating side of the business. We had our final kind of report out of that group, and John and his leadership team and the whole lean initiative team has done a great job to identify opportunities for improved savings across our generation fleet, and we'll continue that, and our hopes is to report that to the board in December and the outcome of our most recent lean activity around our organization. On the safety side, North Omaha Station has gone, and it kind of ties in with the strategic directive today, or at least the monitoring report. Our North Omaha Station has gone 280 days since its last DART injury and 257 days since the last accident of any type. Our peaking stations have surpassed 22 years without a lost time injury or lost time accident. So it's a pretty significant commitment that we shared with the board today on our safety. And again, as OPPD moves forward, we're really seeing this year to be the safest year we've had in the 70 years of OPPD's history. That has to do with the commitment of the senior team, commitment of our management and employees, of the men and women of OPPD, to make sure that we're operating safely across our organization. Renewable energy contributed to about 20% of OPPD's retail energy sales in October 2016. The capacity factor for our wind was 49.8%, almost 50%. Year to date, renewable energy has contributed to about 15.5% of our retail energy, and the capacity factor to date has been 44.8%. Fort Calhoun, obviously we did a briefing with the board today in open session on our Nuclear Oversight Committee on kind of what's going on with Fort Calhoun. The Fort Calhoun shutdown occurred on October 24th. Defueling was completed on November 10th, and the team performed exceptionally well during the coast down and the defueling. And I know both Shane and John and Mary talked very highly of the nuclear safety, industrial safety, environmental safety, radiological safety focus that our men and women had at Fort Calhoun to coast down power, to essentially trip the plant and defuel the plant without incident. And is doing just an exceptional job. And so their continued focus on operational excellence is certainly noted and appreciated. And then several members of the management, senior management team will be out at Fort Calhoun on Monday for our open house meetings out there. And we will certainly compliment them on the great work that they've done as we went through coast down and defueling and do it in a very nuclear professional manner. On the energy delivery side, the transmission and distribution system operated with high reliability. We reported on the reliability monitoring report last month, but we're certainly in the four nines kind of range of reliability. So our system continues to operate at kind of top decile performance. The Midwest Transmission Project, it's about 185-mile line between Kansas City and our Nebraska City plant, has been commissioned, and it will be energized by the end of the year. And our distribution and side of the business has also gone through its lean activity. And that team had its final report out. We're now in the process to implement a variety of initiatives to really to improve processes, to improve ways that we can become more reliable, but also ways that we can become more cost effective. And so Mo and the team, the management team has done a great job there. And the members of the lean team really spent the last 16 weeks identifying ways which we can essentially improve our operations on the distribution side. And that kind of activity will go throughout the whole organization, and we'll report on that as we get significant components of that completed. And the two items I just want to talk about, the OPPD family and the OPPD team, is one, it's our month of giving. It kicks off and runs through November 30th. And so we have a variety of activities going around at OPPD. Those that might have been in the atrium area saw a variety of things going on to support our month of giving, where we have employees working with Heartland Family Services and the Open Door Mission and the food banks. But they are doing a variety of work throughout the month of November, not only in the evenings, but also on weekends as well. And it really, they're living out our core values, which we've identified, which is passion to serve, honoring our community, and caring for each other. And in that process, we're also trying to engage, obviously, all of our employees around the United Way campaign as well, and they're doing a great job. And then we have over 400 employees who have volunteered to serve in American Armed Forces that work here at OPPD. And obviously, since this is Veterans Day, wasn't too many days ago, it's really recognizing our men and women who have been in the military, and many of them had the opportunity to participate in the Defenders of Freedom Parade down in Bellevue, and specifically Patrick Daniel, one of our technology and innovation specialists and a veteran, represented OPPD, and obviously we had a good contingent there. It is an employee resource group that we have developed, OPPD Veterans Group, that, by the way, I think Bart Sedke is the executive sponsor for. So it's just an ongoing way for us to recognize our veterans, but also an opportunity for us to assist them in their development here at OPPD. And with that, that concludes the State of the Utility Report.
Thank you.
It's been a bumpy ride.
Now we would like to have a presentation of the 2017 preliminary corporate operating plan to be presented by Vice President Easterling. Cool.
Equipment.
Do they have it in there?
They're working on it.
They have it on here.
Okay, I'm not sure what we're going to do here because I don't think we have the presentation available to us.
All right. And then go sit down.
Thank you.
Thank you, Edward.
Thank you, Edward. We anticipate the technology coming up.
Let's see if you can get it.
Hopefully.
Give Edward a minute.
Well, since this next item is also a presentation, why don't we go right to the opportunity for comment on other district business? And will you do that at this time while we wait to see if the technology comes returns?
It's working.
The TV's on it, though.
Let's get the weather report first.
I think we should get the weather report. And beyond that, thank you.
Tell us about La Nina.
John Pollock, 1412 North 35th Street. We do have a weak La Nina going. There's slightly better than even chance of it persisting throughout the winter. What's probably more significant for us is that the high-pressure area that's been sitting off the West Coast for several years now in the cool season, combined with a very large area of warm ocean temperatures that's away from the equatorial Pacific, that pattern is reversed. So what we've been seeing this fall is the storm track has moved south over the West Coast, but it's moved north over this part of the country. The result is that we've had a, this is the 28th day in a row of above normal temperatures. We're about to end that streak. It's going to get cooler, a lot cooler this weekend, but it's not going to be exceptionally cold for this time of year. The storm track through our part of the country will probably continue to be weak for the next several weeks to month, if not longer. So we're looking at a rather benign pattern going into the early part of the winter. The big picture is that despite whatever ideas may be going on in Washington in the new year, we've had a snapback from a prolonged period of relatively little apparent global warming. The last El Nino, which is just over, showed that there was still an underlying trend of about 0.2 of a degree a decade, that's in Celsius, of warming. This is going to be the warmest year on record, despite the demise of El Nino, in all likelihood. And we also, for the first time since the records were kept over 40 years ago, have simultaneously record low sea ice for this season in both the Arctic and the Antarctic. It's unusual for them to go in conjunction like that.
30 seconds.
Okay. And to top it off, this is the 14th, well, October was the 14th month in a row of above normal temperatures in Omaha. If that were random, which of course it isn't, we'd expect to see that about once every 1,400 years. So if November comes in, that would be once in every 2,800 years. It's not random. Thank you.
Hey, John, I have a quick question on our global warming. And I don't know, how do they monitor the global temperatures? Because I know they keep shattering. They keep going 2014 hottest year, 2015 hottest year, 2016 hottest year. And that's not random. And you and I both know that.
Yeah.
How do they get those preliminary datas? How do they, are there points on the globe where they
feed it? And there are a number of different research groups that do it around the globe. So you've got about four estimates where they're basically looking at the same data, but they're interpreting it a little differently. It's a combination of land, which is pretty well sampled with the exception of Antarctica, ocean in some areas where you have a lot of ocean going ships, you've got good records. And so that's the really solid, well measured part of it. Then you have satellite estimates and extrapolations. You've got only a few places in the Arctic, the high Arctic. So what you do is you know, you might have a temperature record at Resolute Bay, which is your ground truth, and then you look at what the satellite said it should have been for Resolute Bay and kind of adjust on that basis and extrapolate to, you know, large areas of places like Antarctica, the Southern Ocean, and the central part of the Arctic Ocean, where there are essentially no ground truth records. Mm-hmm. And everybody does it a little differently, and the preliminary estimate gets revised, but typically not more than a few hundredths of a degree as they make these adjustments.
Okay. You got it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our technology has gone into the 21st century, so we'll be able to have the presentations of the corporate operating plan at this time.
So I would just like to report that the sun is out with the corporate operating plan and things are looking good, at least for the next year. So I'm Edward Easterl. I'm Vice President, Chief Financial Officer for OPPD. And I'd like to take a few minutes to go through the corporate operating plan and provide a view of the budget and the plans for operating the business in 2017. As you recall from past discussions, we have known information when we put our plans together, and then we have estimates. And those estimates reflect the best information we have available, and we call those assumptions. And we take the known estimates and the assumptions, and we align those in an effort to try to achieve the directives that were given by the board, so the strategic directives. And so we align everything up to come up with the best plan we can to overall balance with what the board has asked us to accomplish. And in doing that, we've been able to produce a plan that provides no revenue adjustments in 2017. So there's no general rate increase. The fuel and purchase power adjustment will stay the same, so there's no effect on the purchase power adjustment, given the conversation we had this morning and the request we made with that presentation. When we look at the energy sales, the sales we make to our retail customers, and we compare the 2017 budget to the 2016 budget, we see an increase of 0.8% from year to year. When we look at our projection for 2016, that would include actuals through September and then 3 months of projections for the last quarter. We compare those two numbers, it's a 0.7% increase. On the wholesale side, we see a reduction in energy sales in 2017 as a result of the change in the generating portfolio. That change as a result of the decision was made by the Board of Directors in June. Specifically, looking at the 16 versus 17 budget, we see a reduction of 53.1% in energy sales and a reduction of 43.1% when we compare 16 projected to 16 budget. On the expenditure side, capital and operating and maintenance expenditures, we plan those to maintain system reliability and also to meet future load growth. We have included in the plan increased funding for Fort Calhoun Station decommissioning. You'll see that a little bit later as I walk through some of the slides. And also included, we have cost and process improvement reductions of $8.4 million. This is the initiative where we're examining all parts of the business to examine the processes we use, how we conduct our business in a way to become more lean and more efficient in the way we manage the organization. When we look at our capital expenditures, we have included no new revenue bond issues for capital, and we'll touch on that a little bit later. And then the rate stabilization reserve, we are projecting to increase that fund balance from $16 million today to $50 million by the end of next year. And that fund, as you know, is basically an area we go in the event that we need to basically offset revenue shortfalls or unexpected cost increases. That is something that will help us meet the five-year commitment for having no general rate increases. Additional assumptions, as I mentioned, we've included decommissioning expenses, specifically for SafeStore decommissioning. And our planned outages for 17 include a 45-day outage for Nebraska City Unit Number 2, and then a 30-day outage for Sarpy County Unit Number 1. In addition, there are several shorter outages for North Omaha Station and other peaking units. Looking at some of the numbers that are contained in the plan, looking at specifically at revenues and the retail revenues, when we compare the 2017 budget to the 2016 projected, we can see that there's an increase of $7 million between the 2 years. If you think what I think about what I said earlier about the change in energy sales being 0.7%, the difference between the $935 million and the $942 million is 7%. Those two numbers tie out, and it's a result of increasing sales. If we walk through the bar in each of the years, just to this, I'm going to carry this format forward a little bit, so you'll get to, I'm going to explain it to you here so you can apply it as we go forward. We have a historical period starting on the left of 2013 through 2015. We have the projected results for 16 in the next bar. And then the last bar to the right is the budget. Those bars in between 16 and 17 break down the individual components contained in the 17 budget, so you can see them on a standalone basis. The red bar, the red portion of the bar is residential revenue. The blue portion is commercial, industrial is gray, and then the top portion, which is hard for me to tell the color from here, is the smaller bar, is government and municipal. It looks green on my material. On the wholesale side, as I mentioned earlier, with the reduction of energy available for sale, wholesale revenues declined from $162 million in 2016 to $121 million in 2017. That's a $41 million reduction in wholesale revenues. Looking at the components that we include there, we see that the Nebraska City 2 participants, that is actually reduced $2 million. That's just a result of the expenditures we collect from those participants based on the services and the generation they receive from that unit. The red portion is where the material or the major part of the reduction occurs. So it's going from $92 million in 2016 to $53 million in 2017. That's a $39 million reduction, and that is a result of reduced energy available for sale. The next revenue category is other operating revenue and non-operating income. Similar format here, other than we didn't break the bar down for 17. We have three or four items there. The bottom portion of the bar is transmission wheeling revenue. We follow that with investment income in blue, products and services in gray, and then other electric revenues on the top in green. The change between 2016 and 17 is $4 million, and that is being driven by increased investment income. Income is going up as a result of what's happening in the financial markets with interest rates. Interest rates have increased considerably from where they were in 16. Forecasts are that they will continue, and so we've included that in our projections. Looking for moving away from revenue to look at our expenses, on the operation and maintenance side, in 2017, we're projecting an O&M budget of $621 million. That compares to a budget in 2016, or a projection in 16 of $821 million. There's a reduction in the annual budget of $200 million. If you look at the lines, the segments of the lines, you can pretty easily detect where the changes occur. Small change in fuel, there's a reduction there of a $13 million. If you skip over to purchase power, which is, I guess, the more purple color there, there's an increase of $11 million. Those two kind of net each other out. But keep in mind, energy sales are down. So energy sales are down, flats, fuel's kind of flat, which means the cost per unit is going up, as we discussed this morning. We look at production expenses, there's a $167 million reduction there, and a $34 million reduction in A&G expense. Moving from O&M, we've included the Fort Calhoun Station decommissioning expenditures. We're projecting expenditures of $29 million in 2016 and $174 million in 2017. So while O&M is down, the savings in O&M is going to pay for the expenditures associated with decommissioning. On the capital expenditure side, we're projecting $135 million. compared to $172 million in 2016. The color coding there is the bottom portion. The red portion is transmission and distribution. We then have, in the historical period, nuclear production. In the blue, it is not reflected in 2016 projection and beyond. We have other in the gray, which is basically general plant. They're capital projects that support all functions throughout the district, so we call that other. And then fossil production on the top, which is shown as green. Large capital projects included in those capital totals I just provided. We have Nebraska City Landfill, $6 million. This is to provide a new landfill for the landfill that we're using there today that should be full by 2019, so we need to start construction on the next facility. We have the Nebraska City Unit 2 High Pressure Intermediate Pressure Turbine Rotor Replacement. This is to replace the rotor that was damaged and repaired but not fully restored during the prior outage. We have the Elkhorn River Valley Transmission Line at $12 million. We have our TDIP program, Transmission Distribution Improvement Program, at $10 million, and then Enterprise Communications of $2 million. That would be in the general category that I mentioned earlier. For our capital program, we're projected to be able to fund the capital from internally available funds without any new bond issues, so no projected issues in 16 or 17. If we pull our revenues and expenses together to look at net income, for 2017, we're projected at $66 million, and that includes a transfer to the rate stabilization reserve of $15 million. When we look at 2016, it shows $37 million, including a $19 million transfer to the rate stabilization reserve. Now, just as a reminder, we do have a large expenditure that we recorded in June that's not reflected in these numbers. It's down in the footnote. So in actuality, we have a loss in 2016, but this is telling you what it would be absent that loss. As mentioned earlier, we're currently at $16 million in a rate stabilization reserve. By the end of the year, we plan to transfer additional funds to get to $35 million by the end of 16, and then $50 million by the end of 2017. And these funds would be available to, as I said, offset any unexpected cost expenses or increases or revenue reductions that were unanticipated within the plan to avoid a rate increase. I think we're missing something here. I'm going to go ahead and cover this. We have a decommissioning fund balance. And the decommissioning funding at the end of 2016 is $362 million, and in 17 is $335 million. So as we spend those funds that I mentioned earlier, and we're putting funds back in, we're maintaining that balance above $300 million as we work through that project. The next is the debt ratio. In 2017, we're projected to be at 64%. An improvement from where we are today in 2016 at 66%, and both of those values are above where we have been historically, which is around 50 to 52%. This increase, as you know, was related to asset write-offs with the June decision. The next financial metric we'll look at is related to coverage. We have total debt service coverage target of greater than or equal to 2x. And that is shown in the light green line in the middle. And you can see that in 2016, we're projected to be about 1.9. And in 2017, we're projected at 2x. The line above it is the senior lien bond coverage ratio. The reason that goes from 2.11 to 3.5 in 2017 is based on the language and the formula that's in the bond resolution for those particular bonds. When you reduce the O&M expense, as projected in here, it improves that ratio, and you do not put in the decommissioning expense. So we've reduced O&M without the inclusion of decommissioning based on the way that language works. And so you see the increase in the ratio. When you look at total debt service, and you look at the fixed charge, that includes the decommissioning expense. So,
okay, so you should look at really the total debt service.
Exactly. That's why we use that as the target. So moving from our ratios to our cash available on hand, we have a minimum of 100 days cash. We determine this based on the risk profiles and the probability of risk occurrence to say, given this risk profile, how much money do we need to maintain in the event that these risks actually do materialize? And based on that, we come up with 100 days of cash. Projected 2016, we're at 170 days, and 2017, 198 days. And as in the past, we have retained new gen strategies and solutions to evaluate OPPD's budget, the process, and the results of the process with regard to our strategic directives. They have been in the company, they have talked to staff, they've challenged, they've reviewed everything, they're in the process of pulling everything together, and they will have a letter or findings to you before the December board meeting with regard to their opinions on the process and the results. So in summary, our mission is to provide affordable, reliable, environmentally sensitive energy service to our customers, also known as Strategic Directive 1A. The COP, the Corporate Operating Plan, is aligned with our mission, and that entails keeping rates below the regional national average, SD2, providing system reliability, SD4, and also renewable resources, which are projected to provide 25% of retail energy in 2017, SD7. We will continue to manage our O&M expenditures and look for continuous improvement opportunities, as well as O&M within decommissioning and in capital, and look to identify and manage risk. So as risk is identified and managed, we don't have unexpected outcomes with regard to the results of our plan. So from a public notice standpoint, we're presenting this information to you today. The plan would be to come back to you in December and ask for your approval of the corporate operating plan. Any questions?
I have a...
The O&M savings, what percentage of that is actually being used in the decommissioning, or do you have that number? I didn't see anything that broke down our O&M savings and where each item was going. I realize some of it's going back into the rate stabilization fund, and I didn't know whether some of it was going back into the retirement fund. I know that we took some out of that last year. Or didn't put it in.
We reduced the funding level, right?
And I was just wondering if there's any breakdown on where all of the O&M savings is going. If there was, I didn't see it up there.
No. I kind of mentioned it as I went, but I didn't put a complete picture together. So I don't have that in front of me, but I can give you a general answer.
Yes.
So our O&M reduction is about $200 million. Of that $200 million, $174 million is going into pay for decommissioning.
Really?
And then we have about $19 million that's being transferred into the rate stabilization reserve. And then at the end, you can see there's a little bit of increase in our cash balance. So what we're doing is we're taking the savings, we're managing our way through, we're trying to increase some reserves for the unexpected with regard to any potential adjustments in our plans around decommissioning so that we don't have to come back and ask for a rate increase. So that's kind of the plan going forward, and we're working it as best we can.
Does that mean out of your decommissioning fund, you're only going to be taking about $27 million out? Or when you say the decommissioning fund goes from $362 million to $335 million because you're going to be using the...
That's the net change.
That's a net change.
So we're taking out, we're spending, I think it's, let me see, we're spending $147 million. And we're putting 174 in.
Spending 174.
Putting 147 in. Thank you.
So it drops in 17.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
Thank you.
And then there's a slight decrease in the amount of T&D that you're using. Is that because of the lean process, or what's the reason for that?
I would say we have adopted a new capital review and approval process, mm-hmm. whereby we are including additional, I would say, challenges in capital, and we are making a very concerted effort not to require bond financing to try to manage our capital program within the available funding that we have so that we can work down this path of no rate increase. So with that, we have taken project by project reviews, and we have specifically set criteria to try to reduce capital where we can, but spend it where we need to. Mm-hmm. And so it's really around providing reliability and meeting load growth, but trying to use some of the, I would say, some of the capacity we built into the system without adding maybe more than we need to at the moment.
Okay. Thank you. That was one question. And then can you describe what Enterprise Communications is?
Specifically, that's around a new telephone system, communication system for the organization. Our system today is somewhat out of date, and it plays a large role in the customer interface. And so Kate's probably a better person to answer that than I am. But it really relates to communications, not only for employees, but interface and effectiveness with the customers.
Okay, could you explain that a little bit for everybody?
I can.
Because this is something different on the docket than we've had before, since Kate's here.
Thank you for the question. What it is we do have an aged telephone system in our environment that is in all our facilities, and we're replacing it with a more current, modern, using voice over IP, which is how current telephone systems work, which also allows you to connect up devices to it, whereas today you cannot do that. So this is a total replacement. That's what those dollars are, to get our communication system across the district up to speed.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
And I would just say, part of the capital process that Edward spoke to certainly is driven not only by some of the lean initiatives that we looked at about the process to go through to scrutinize projects, and just give you a quick example on a handful of projects that we reviewed in 16, we were able to reduce $5 to $8 million of potential capital budgeting dollars by looking at those in a little different way than we've historically looked at them. And then on the budgeting process for the business technology side, we actually go through kind of a corporate prioritization and rating. And it's really looking at the value proposition that those capital expenditures provide to the organization. So this is one, obviously, that it's in our budget, has raised to the point to create value and opportunity within the organization and reduce other costs that we have currently in play.
Good.
I have one more question. Is it safe to assume that in the next few years, the O&M will be approximately the same, and the amount of money going into the decommissioning fund would be less? Is that a good assumption, or will it remain pretty much as it is?
Or increase slightly.
Really? Okay.
And I would say on the O&M, since you raised that question, Director Hurley, is that our intent is, as we begin to implement the projects identified through lean fossil, lean distribution, and other lean activity through the organization, that we're going to see those savings and certainly try to mitigate any increases in O&M, but potentially look at reductions of additional O&M in the future as well. And I think we have a glide path to be able to do that over the next 3 to 5 years. So that's the senior team's commitment to execute those strategies. So,
and I had one other question. Rich mentioned that he and I and a lot of the other VPs went up to the Grand Prairie Farm. That we're not going to take full access of that until June, is that correct? Is that why it's only 25%? And after Grand Prairie's, and as far as renewable sources, what would that be?
The contract, I believe, I think the contract date for accepting the output is, I believe, June, May or June. And so we have modeled our projections that way. It was modeled that way because we were unsure at the time as to what the transmission requirements would be. Mm-hmm. We're getting a better picture of that. I know right now during a testing period, I think we're taking the output of that. But I think we have some flexibility going forward, depending on how the transmission studies come out, as to whether we would take it or it would be a market sale. But nonetheless, next year it becomes our purchase for our use.
In June, yeah.
And yes, and that's reflected. So it doesn't have the full year included in there. So if we take more output, the renewable percentage would go up.
So this is the conservative estimate of the amount of renewables.
Yes.
Since we really only have about 6 months of the full Grand Prairie in that.
Correct.
Okay.
Edward, please recap. No rate increase in 17. And approximately how much savings in O&M that are going to be used to keep rates low?
Okay, so in 2017, the rates that we have today will remain in place with no rate changes, no increases, no additional revenue.
Right.
Just a minor reminder that we have a rate restructuring that's still being phased in over time that was approved last year. That's revenue neutral. Right. There's no revenue coming in from those changes. So revenues remain relatively flat with the exception of any additional sales of energy, which you saw in the graphs. And so we're working within that, and allowing us to do that is a reduction of $200 million in O&M that's providing the opportunity to fund decommissioning expenses, also fund our capital expenditures without borrowing and increasing our overall fixed costs, and adding some additional funding into our reserves for the unexpected.
And if we didn't have that service rate increase, would we have to increase rates?
If we didn't have that
service. That $5 that is going to be increasing.
It's revenue neutral. There's no additional revenue from that.
Okay. But if we didn't have
We're going to change the fixed fee and reduce the energy rate.
Right.
And in total, there's no additional revenues. It's just a restructuring.
But what I'm asking is if we didn't have that service charge at all, what would happen to our rates?
Our rates, in theory, with normal weather, would be what we're presenting. However, when you have unexpected events like mild weather or extreme weather, it introduces volatility into your revenue stream, or other things that happen with regard to continued usage patterns, it increases volatility. So what the restructuring really does is provides more stability in our rate structure and our revenue stream. So there's less likelihood that we would come back in the future and ask for rate increases for things that are causing us to move around because we're getting a disproportionate amount of our revenues from a variable feature. If 70% of our cost is fixed, but we're collecting 90% based on usage, there's not the proper match between our cost structure and our revenue structure. So we're not trying to get 100% matched. We're just going maybe to 30%.
We're only 70-30 instead of 90-10.
Yep.
Okay.
Bravo. Yeah,
good work by the team.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank
you. Good work on by the team.
Okay.
Any questions of the public on the presentation? Not, then we'll move on to the next presentation, which is Integrated Resource Plan Update. And I believe Brad Underwood is going to be doing that.
Thank you, Ms. Tracy. Thank you, Director Green. Well, today I'm very pleased to give a status on the update for our integrated resource planning efforts. As the slide suggests, I'm the Director of Corporate Planning and Analysis, and like to walk you through the efforts of our resource planning so far. The various topics we'll discuss today is we'll provide a brief overview on integrated resource plans, kind of the purpose of the plans, how we prepare them. We do carry some assumptions into those plans, so we'll spend some time discussing those. We created a sampling of portfolios that we feel have unique attributes that are associated with each of those portfolios, and we'll look at those portfolios in detail. Once we complete the detailed review of the portfolios, we'll look at a stochastic review of all four of the portfolios. That stochastic review will really provide us an indication of overall risk that may or may not be associated with each of the portfolios. Once we get through the risk discussion, we'll kind of stack those portfolios up side by side, and we'll do a comparative review on each of those as they relate to each other. Finally, we do have a stakeholder outreach plan that we would like to execute here in the next 30 to 45 days, and then any sort of next steps. So the Integrated Resource Plan is a comprehensive forward-looking decision support tool utilized in evaluating the efficiency of options to serve electrical requirements. Maybe at a more practical level, what that means is you have a number of variables that are going on in your environment. You have a load variable, you have a technology variable, you have a fuel prices variable. And so the effort really focuses around how do we understand each of those variables, how do we aggregate them, and then how do we make the best decision based on how those variables interact. Integrated resource planning is critical as the utility industry and OPPD experiences dynamic change in a compressed amount of time. And IRPs will evolve over time, and they'll be reflective of our changing environment. And they are very directional in nature, maybe now so more than ever as we experience the amount of change that we're experiencing. Part of the purpose of the IRP is to fulfill our contractual commitment to the Western Area Power Administration. So we receive hydroelectric power from WAPA. Part of that power agreement is that we will provide an integrated resource planning, our integrated resource plan. That plan, our intention is to file a five-year plan with WAPA. As we prepare the plan, there are a number of very distinct, sometimes competing interests that have a healthy amount of tension associated with them. And we've got those itemized here on the slide. But the first of those is Strategic Directive 2. And obviously, we have a direction and a goal that we're going to achieve rates at 20% below the regional average. We have reliability directives where we want to maintain an adequate grid as we operate the system on behalf of the ratepayer. There's an environmental stewardship that's present here during this work where we want at least 30% of our retail sales to come from renewable energy sources, and we also want to be compliant with any environmental standards that are in effect. Strategic Directive 9 is the directive to complete this exercise. So periodically, we will assess the district's generation mix, the PPA agreements, as well as the demand side management for appropriateness. Economic development is our directive that we keep rates low and competitive in order to facilitate growth and economic development in the area and in our service territory. We also are excited to complete a Strategic Directive 13, which is a stakeholder outreach. The way we see that directive in this context is we want to give people an opportunity to comment on the process, to ask questions about the process, to have access to us as we go through the exercise so that we can bring those comments back for management and board's consideration as we progress into the future. Finally, you'll see a Strategic Directive 15 up there for enterprise risk management. We want to make sure that as we go through the effort, we want to stay within the bounds of our current enterprise risk management program. As we prepare the plan, there are a number of inputs that reflect our seemingly constantly changing energy landscape. I've listed four of these up here to give you an example. They're fuel costs, power prices, resources cost, and different technology options. On the next slide, you can see the various technologies and resources that we considered as we went through the planning effort. Some of these will look very, very familiar to you from what you may or may not have seen from the Fort Calhoun Station analysis. I will point out bullet point 4 and bullet point 5. We have evaluated new utility grade solar and new wind. The cost inputs that we used during that evaluation were as a result of the competitive request for proposal that the district recently completed. So we feel like we have real good up-to-date information for those components. Some of the various assumptions that we make. The Southwest Power Pool, which is the regional transmission organization that we operate the system in, does impose a reserve margin. That reserve margin is 12%. So at any given point, we have a peak load where that's an energy demand for us, and then we go 12% above it. We have resources 12% above to make sure we can satisfy any increase to our peak load that we may experience. We also said, told the modeling that we don't want to generate electricity that exceeds 30% above OPPD's retail load. That was put in place to mitigate our market and our operational risk in a sense that we don't want to generate too much energy and we don't want the market exposure associated with that. The third bullet point is North Omaha is maintained in its current state through 2018. So the intent there was we said, hey, if there's an optimization potential here and we want to make a change to North Omaha, please do not suggest that prior to 2018 because we want to have time to understand that and potentially react to it. And finally, the duration of the study was in fact 20 years from 2017 to 2036. Kind of the final set of assumptions that we use is there was a handful of things that we were able to update from the efforts that we went through from the Fort Calhoun Station modeling. We did update market-related inputs, so any sort of newer information that we had regarding fuel prices, regarding kind of generic wind within the SPP solar, and then also costs that are, estimates that we had for new utility-grade solar and wind that we got as a response from the request for proposal. We did also kind of calibrate our incorporated our site-specific generation estimates, and what we mean by that is we have different technology options at different sites, and so we went through an effort to sort of understand that and make sure that we had the right estimates for site-specific technologies at site-specific locations. And then we did go ahead and update the model that we made the decision, the board made the decision to retain North Omaha 1 through 3 on gas for capacity purposes, as that was a low-cost capacity option from the time we made the decision in June. We also told the model we don't want to entertain anything that does not comply with the Clean Power Plan. So that was a requirement. Obviously, there's a lot of uncertainty regarding the Clean Power Plan, but we did not want to be in a situation where we weren't potentially ready to react to that in a prudent way. As we get out of the assumptions here, we'll get into the sample portfolios that we created. There were four of them, and as you can see from the summary slide, the four portfolios have some attributes in common, and they have some attributes that are unique. And so, obviously, you can see from the portfolios on the left, going from blue, yellow, orange, and pink, that's how the portfolios will be identified from here on out. We have a percent renewables growth, and then we also have an economic evaluation of our demand-side management program. All four of these portfolios also include additional wind resources. And then in the last two columns, you get into a solar and battery criteria, and in portfolio yellow, there is a representation from battery, and in portfolio orange, there is a representation for utility-grade solar. So the first of the four portfolios is portfolio blue. Like you may have seen on the last slide, there was a constraint that we said we don't want to exceed 50% renewables as a percentage of our retail sales. And then for those of you that are familiar with obviously the Fort Calhoun analysis, this is the portfolio that most closely reflects the rebalanced portfolio that we talked about previously. And so if these two look very, very similar, both the rebalanced and portfolio blue, that's the reason why we sort of expected that after the analysis. So there are a handful of suggested changes in the near term from 2017 to 2021 associated with portfolio blue. The first one is you can see itemized in 2017, which is that we reevaluate 46 megawatts of our planned DSM programs. So we have a board resolution that identifies our demand side management program at 300 megawatts. When we went through the optimization process within the modeling, the model identified 46 megawatts that were identified as uneconomic that said you should probably go back and take another look at those 46 megawatts. The reason those 46 megawatts were identified as uneconomic is if you think back to the end of 2013, early 2014, when we did the AEG study with demand side management, since then, capacity costs have fallen considerably, and so that's effectively what's pushing these things into uneconomic space as opposed to previously when they were more economic. In 2018, you see the entrance of potentially of 160 megawatts of wind, and in 2020, you see 266 megawatts of wind. So just to kind of highlight that similarity between portfolio blue and the rebalanced portfolio, that was approximately additional 400 megawatts of energy, and you see that here.
And Brad, the 46 megawatts, the revaluation is a really around
what class of customer?
Yeah, thank you, President Burke. It is business direct load control, or some people may call it business curtailable. So it is not a part of residential. Those programs would continue in full force and effect. Some additional attributes of Portfolio Blue. You can see the net present value cost is $5.199 billion. It's important for us to understand that if you recall, the duration of the study was 20 years. So this is the net cost to operate this entire portfolio over 20 years. So make sure we think about it correctly from a duration perspective. And then on an emissions perspective, you can see that there is a significant and meaningful drop in emissions. That data is comparative from the end of 2015 actuals to kind of a midpoint in the 20-year period. We picked 2025 because it was a clean 10 years from 2015 to 2025. So we're pleased to see potentially that that drop in emissions associated with this portfolio. So a quick look at energy sources. So here's a graph of our different generating sources. You can see in the bottom left, there's the nuclear one. We would not expect to receive nuclear generation in 2017, and that's reflected here. You also see the black vertical lines, which encapsulates the five-year period. And probably the story here that we found most interesting was if you start back in 2010, 2011, you see kind of the sliver of renewables, and then as you progress more into 14, 15, and 16, that slice grows. And then as you go into 17 and 18, you've got the inclusion of Grand Prairie, to Director McGuire's point earlier. And then hypothetically in this portfolio, you'd have more wind in 2018 and 2020. So we really see the presence of renewables grow, both before the five-year plan study and within the current five-year plan study. The second portfolio maintains the constraint of not to exceed 50% renewables relative to retail sales. And it also includes a 10 megawatt battery. So you can see here that the same conclusion is made on the 46 megawatts of demand side management program. Very similar suggestion to Portfolio Blue, where 160 megawatts of wind would be incorporated in 2018. And then in 2020, you see that same 266 megawatts of wind. And then we placed the battery in this year partly because it was our lowest. We had adequate capacity, but it was our lowest capacity year. So it just made sense to incorporate that battery at that point. From a cost perspective, $5.2 billion over a 20-year period. So if you're kind of doing the math in your head relative to yellow, it's a small uptick. And then again, you see a meaningful reductions in emissions, which we would expect with the inclusion of this much wind and with the portfolio changes that we've made. So similar graph to Portfolio Blue, you can see this is actually pretty much the exact same data. What you don't see here is a battery. That's not considered a traditional fuel source, but that is the only difference from blue to yellow. So our third portfolio, this is the last one that maintains the constraint of 50% renewables relative to retail sales. It does include 100 megawatts of utility grade solar. And so if you look at the five-year proposed changes, we see the 46 megawatts of demand-side management, which we would expect to see at this point. Very similar recommendation in 2018 for 160 megawatts of wind. And then in 2020, what happens is, if you recall, that previous recommendation was 266 megawatts of wind. Basically, 100 of wind is displaced with 100 of solar. Another climb in our NPV cost, and then again, a fairly consistent reduction in emissions. Here's what that looks like from a fuel sources or an energy perspective. And so you see the purple there, that's the additional layer in there that begins in 2020 and continues through the study period. And then the last portfolio we created as a sample was had a maximum constraint of 40% renewables relative to retail sales. And it's a little bit more of a moderated inclusion of renewables. So if you think to this year, we'll be about you know, approximately 15-16% of retail sales. Vice President Easterlin talked about next year how that's a small climb to go, or another noticeable climb to go to about 25%. And then here would be a stop at 40% instead of going all the way to 50%. We wanted to understand what that looked like. So 2017, the last recommendation for 46 megawatts of demand-side management be evaluated, and then you only have in 2018 a recommendation of 160 megawatts of wind. The portfolio has an assumed net present value cost of $5.4 billion, and again, still decreasing emissions significantly. Here's what that looks like linearly over the study period. You can see the 5 years there in between the vertical black lines, and then through the end of the study period. So now that we've gotten through kind of a detailed look at each of the four portfolios, we'd like to show you kind of the risk perspective of each of those portfolios. And the tool that we use to do that is a stochastics analysis. So what the stochastics analysis will do is it sort of will tell us the cost-risk trade-off that a lot of us are used to. And what happens is the model inputs that we talked about, be it fuel prices, load, technology cost, we take those and we intentionally make them volatile, and we make a move, and we want to understand what consequence that has. And the conclusion of the stochastic analysis is a distribution of potential outcomes. And so here's the drivers that I talked about kind of in the middle of the slide on the far left. So we take those inputs and we intentionally introduce volatility to them. And then the result is an updated power price. It affects the way that units are dispatched within the model, how wind penetrates within our footprint, and obviously the total portfolio cost. Another item that's noteworthy here is for each of the four portfolios, blue, yellow, orange, and pink, we have done 200 different scenarios for each of those four portfolios. So we feel like we've got a reasonable amount of potential outcomes associated with each of those portfolios to review. So here's a brief image of what that looks like graphically. You can see the gas prices in the top left and the coal prices in the bottom left. And what we're doing is we're just increasing them and decreasing them. And we're trying to derive what kind of power prices that results in within the model, and then how that affects our overall portfolio cost. Here's a very similar graph as it relates to load. So you can see the peak is about 12.5 million megawatt hours of load, and the trough there is slightly over 8, maybe to close to 9. So even if you varied load, what would that look like? Here's a slide that you probably recall from the Fort Calhoun analysis, and I'll just explain the axes real quick, briefly, and then we'll talk about where what those dots mean. So on the bottom is the mean net present value of all the portfolios. So when we go through the 200 different simulations, we're telling the model, hey, can you give me the mean of the net present value, which would obviously just be the average of all 200. And then on the left, we're trying to get an indication of risk. And so the conditional value at risk, which is CVAR 90. Basically what it does is for our 200 portfolios that we ran, or 200 iterations of the same portfolio that we ran, it excludes 180 of those portfolios, which is 90%. It excludes the cheapest of those portfolios, and it says, tell me the 20 most expensive portfolios and tell me the mean of those portfolios. So worst case perspective from a cost perspective, tell me the average of that worst case. So in the top right was the baseline scenario, and then the impact of ceasing operations at Fort Calhoun in June. You can see that mean net present value move considerably to the left, and you can see the CVAR 90 indication drop considerably. And so as you move to the bottom left corner of the graph, that's essentially an optimization from a cost perspective as well as a risk perspective. So keeping those two portfolios in baseline and rebalanced, we wanted to plot where the additional four portfolios that we sampled would lie. So you see there, right below rebalanced, a pink portfolio at 40% renewable. So you get a little bit of you get a little bit of reduction of cost and a little bit of reduction of risk. Orange is a comparable jump. You move down and left a little bit more, and then blue and yellow is sort of the lowest cost, lowest risk portfolios according to these indicators. So now that we've looked at the four portfolios and the risk that's associated with each of those four portfolios, let's look at the attributes comparatively across all four. So this graph is an energy sources summary, which is based on 2025 generation, which is sort of a midpoint that we identified in the study period. Blue and yellow look very, very close. Again, the only difference is an incremental battery. The orange portfolio includes the 100 megawatts of utility grade solar, and you see that represented at the top of that stack in purple. And then in pink, where you only go to 40% renewables, you see a larger concentration of coal and a smaller concentration of renewables relative to the other portfolios. And again, this is expressed as a percent of total generation. Here's an analysis or a summary slide on the demand side management program. So all four scenarios or all four portfolios identified that 46 megawatts that we should take another look at. So you can see the black line at the top. That's the 300 megawatt program, and then you can see the 254 that we did not have an uneconomic issue with, and the 46 that we did. Ideally, the discussion was to replace the 46 megawatts with another program that was more economic, and so that's kind of how we left that for the time being. And then, if you're curious on, you know, what is the overall status of the 300 megawatt program, I've included a note at the bottom that 12 megawatts of energy efficiency are implemented, and 110 megawatts of demand response out of the total 300 megawatt program have been implemented. So here's a financial summary. Portfolios on the left, some of their key attributes in the second column, and then we've compared the total cost of each portfolio as we looked at the portfolio details, and then comparatively the incremental cost. So I'm going to talk about the far right column, but when you move from yellow to blue, you see a small increase of $16.9 million. When you move from blue to orange, you see an increase of $199 million over the 20-year period, and then as you move from blue to pink, you see an increase of $280 million over the 20-year period. Emissions summary, very, very comparable. We saw that in all the portfolio detail slide, but I wanted to include a slide for those as we summarize the emissions attribute. Like I mentioned earlier, we do have intentions of a stakeholder outreach. We've been working hand in hand with our CorpCom group, and we think we've got a good plan going forward. That process would essentially start today in November, and then continue through December. There'll be information releases on social media, and then we'll be reaching out to our governmental affairs groups as well as economic development stakeholders. And then information, all of this content is, if it's not already, it will be shortly posted on OPPD Listens. And I believe there'll also be a link from the wire. The nice thing about OPPD Listens is that's actually a comment mechanism. So if you haven't been out there, that's a great way to get us your comments. And then if you don't want to do that electronically, we'll also be out at the outreach at the open houses. So we plan to do three of those. We'll do one at UNO here in the metro, and then we'll do one at Blair and one down in Syracuse. So this will be available online, but real quick, here's a more detailed look at kind of the schedule. I'll just point out a couple things here. November 29th, November 30th, and December 1st, those are the in-person open houses. And then every week you see starting on November 21st and then November 28th, and then as you go down through the list, there'll be a weekly feedback report that's provided to the board. Our friends at CorpCom will do that, and I know they'll do that well. So we intend to do that. But that's the total schedule. And then ideally, we would bring back the results from the stakeholder process and report back out in December. So there's a few next steps that we'll keep working on. So like I mentioned, the stakeholder feedback. We'll also spend some time evaluating the pursuit of common resources across the portfolio. So we'll continue our work there. We'll aggregate the feedback and bring that back to you in December based on what we've heard. The intention is to file with WAPA in early 2017. And then this process will not stop. It may not be a full-blown IRP, but as far as generation reviews, we intend to continue this process into the future.
And Brad, let me just expand on that second bullet here. So I think what we want to say in this is that as we see the common elements in each of those portfolios, and based on maybe some feedback or perspective that we get in the stakeholder mm-hmm. process, that we may come back as early as December with some actions that we would ask the board to pursue if in this example it may be wind or any of the other renewables to really maximize our opportunity to capture the PTC in negotiation. Yeah. So it could be as early as December, just to be very clear about that, and that's what we'll evaluate over the next 30 days.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea because you don't know if the PTC is going to be there next year.
All indications would say, I don't think, though, at least what we're hearing in my meeting yesterday, is that there probably will not be an extension beyond the end date over the next 4 years after 16. At least the scuttlebutt that we're hearing is that there's no intent to take that back to zero in 17. They'll let that law run its way through over the next 4 years and cascade down 20% a year till it gets to nothing. But as we begin to think about this, we certainly may want to take advantage of it earlier than later and understand what those impacts are. So that could potentially happen. We won't know that until we work through the process. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to be clear about what that may look like or potentially look like in December.
You know, Brad, can you discuss the battery storage and what your thought process behind that was? I would think that'd be a peaking type unit, but you don't have it in the baseline, but it's the same thing except you've got the peaking, and I'm wondering, is that instead of using peaking someplace else?
Yeah, no, well, that's a great question. Thank you, Director McGuire. So the original intent was as our portfolio grows in renewables, there's a sort of a conclusion that we may make that, hey, batteries will become more relevant as renewables grow. In addition to that, you have the declining cost curve of batteries. So what started up here is now at some point here, and it'll go down to here. And so we're not quite at the point where the model selected it as economic. And that's why we saw a small increase in the total net present value cost. But we thought it could potentially be beneficial, depending upon stakeholder feedback, to understand batteries, actually incorporate it into the system, understand how they operate, understand how we could use them both in a, from deploying the battery in a peak load perspective where prices are high, and then charging or energizing the battery when prices are low.
And I have one other question. In the future, I see us utilizing people, the consumers, the customers, using more and more of their own distributed generation. Did you put any of that into your stochastics?
We did not include DG in our modeling efforts. We're certainly aware of distributed generation. We are in the process of trying to understand that better from a quantitative basis. So where is the right data? How do we use that data? And then what does it look like in context of our portfolio? And that would be something we would continue.
That's a continuing
into
thing
the
to
future.
Look at.
Yeah.
And I would just say we have a strategic initiative team developing kind of what that strategy looks like from an integrated marketplace perspective. And part of that would be to incorporate not only what we believe that future looks like from that kind of distributed piece, but also what OPPD's role would be in that piece. And so that team is just being organized now. We'll kind of kick off, and obviously we'll share some of the broad scope of what each of these strategic initiatives teams do. Our plan is to do that next month in the committee meetings, just to give you an idea on kind of here's the direction of some of the initiatives that we're looking at, and that we'll come back to the board and report on as progress develops around that.
Thank you.
Your modeling is it looks out 20 years, and a strategic part of that is natural gas.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do you take into account increases and decreases in the process?
Yeah.
And then understanding this is a snapshot in time, right? Mm-hmm. And this is what we think may think today, and it may change dramatically based on clean power plan, based on all kinds of, am I right?
Yes, sir. Yeah, okay. That's a wonderful question. You're absolutely right. So one of the ways that we try and account for the volatility of gas pricing is in that stochastics piece. So one of the inputs that we have is the price of natural gas. And when we input it at varying levels. And so that we understand what happens if natural gas prices rise, you know, materially, or what happens if they decrease materially, and then that is reported back to us within those 200 iterations of each portfolio. Yeah.
Okay. Well done.
Yep.
That's a good thing.
But it's amazing just the change that has occurred from 2014 to the prices that we received the beginning, first quarter, second quarter of 2016, even, and what we went back out in the market. And what we're getting from the folks that supply the RFPs is, we want you to come back out because we think prices may even be lower than what we've sent you. So this is a competitive market really driving some opportunity for us. And that's the reason why you see that risk portfolio change from where we saw the rebalance portfolio as it's moved down. We've seen lower prices and lower risk elements around those. So that's the changes. So the snapshot is important because we know it's going to change, right? So we don't want people to get hung up and say, that's what we're going to do for the next 20 years, because I don't know what other new technologies or other distributed technologies or how we'll incorporate those and integrate those in the marketplace, what that's going to look like 5, 10, or 15 years from now. And that's part of our strategic initiative we're going to try to work through and understand what that looks like for us.
Any other questions I can answer?
Any other questions? Outstanding.
Thanks. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. You'll be tested on the material before you're allowed to leave. That generally concludes the scheduled portion of our meeting. At this time is the opportunity for comment and other items of district business if someone wishes to do so.
I have some specific questions on the last presentation, and one of them is if they've considered the Tesla, Musk, and the Solar City development of solar tiles for roofs, replacement of shingles?
I would say it's not in this analysis that we've seen. As utility grade integrated resource portfolio, but I think you'll see that thought and that conversation occur as we begin to think about the integrated marketplace today.
No, so, just my question is, though, has that entered into the considerations?
Not in this presentation today, no.
Has it, into the OPPD chain, has it entered into it? It's a recent development within the last month.
But that's what we're going to be evaluating as we move forward. All those technologies, not just that.
The answer is no, then.
Not today.
Okay. And then did they consider hydrogen production from the windmills when they don't need the electricity, when it's overproduction, to produce hydrogen?
No, sir, we did not.
Okay. And then the battery, well, it's one of the techniques that's been around forever, producing hydrogen from electric current. And it's been mentioned off and on through the years, but as things change, and you've got the capability to use the hydrogen in your gas plants and your turbine plants, but I just wonder if that came up in your...
Yeah, I think our perspective would be this, is that we would look at proven technologies. I don't think our customer owners really want us to be a alpha or beta test site and understand the risk of that kind of a test, but we will certainly early adopt proven technologies. And so I think we'll look at all of those developments as they occur and as they become proven and incorporate them as they are appropriate within our business model.
Well, my question only is if you're looking at it, if you say, no, that's okay with me, then I can submit.
We're looking at everything.
All right.
Okay. We will. But it'll be proven technologies.
We're not going to be in a science project. I don't think that's where we ought to be.
But the things I'm mentioning are proven technologies. Musk's going to come on the market in 6 months with the roof tiles, and the hydrogen production from electrical sources has been around for, well, when I was in high school, they did it.
So certainly what we've seen on some of these early technologies is that they're much more costly. That's why they don't fit into the model that we've seen today.
Okay.
Long-term, what you see in new technologies is the curve that occurs as they become produced more, as they become likely to be purchased in the marketplace. Those costs come down. Then they may become more opportunistic for us.
Yeah, I think what Mr. Burke may have been trying to get to previously is that when it comes to the inclusion of solar in the portfolio, the best shot that we had at that was utility grade, or that we have at that is utility grade solar. If the rooftop, or if the discussion shifts to smaller scale solar generation, then it becomes more challenging on an NPV basis.
Here again, my question is, I'm not trying to argue the point or promote it. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying, have you seen the Elon Musk Solar City Tesla thing?
Yes.
And if you have seen it, and the rooftop solars,
Yes, we have.
It just, and they say it's going to be on the market in 6 months, which is going to have a huge effect, I would think, on your retail market, and maybe even more so on your commercial and utility owner. But anyway, that's my question. If you've seen it, fine. Okay.
Mr. Rose.
Mr. Rose?
Again, you know, I am already good to myself. I come here today on behalf as a customer owner for the arduous experience I've had to deal with OPPD, customer reps, and the policies and procedures. without further ado, like I said, on 9/28/16, an orange staff was placed at my door, indicating that due to unsafe conditions, an order has been issued to turn off your power, so forth. I called the number provided on the flyer that's stated right here on this flyer. I called it several times, left two voicemails, called prior to this being placed at my door, indicating why my power is deemed unsafe. I was told a roof plate. A roof plate disconnected my power. I went to get that replaced, as stated from your customer service reps. I did that. I called back indicating that that was fixed. She indicated that that was not good enough. I needed an electrician to come out. I am not familiar with the electrician field. I don't know the jargon. I do not know what a roof riser and so forth is. I was not provided the opportunity to have my phone call returned or provide information that is allowing me to what needs repairs need to be done, especially if you're putting this tap on my door indicating to disconnect my services. Therefore, I stand here before you seeking answers, justifications as to your policies for my concerns. First and foremost, what department issues these and who in particular put this at my door? The wrong date was even addressed on my on this. So, Chair.
Let's see, that would be Julie.
And just to let the board know, I had an opportunity to talk to Mr. Rose before and said that more than likely we would have both Julie and Steve maybe meet with them, because I think there was some communication that we provided that maybe didn't get into his hands, and so we got to work through what that may look like. But Julie, I'll let you give some perspective.
Yeah, so I can give a general perspective of what typically happens, and what started in the case of Mr. Rose's, how safety hazards often get identified is after a storm event has occurred. Sometimes we have the roof risers and the wires are pulled away from the roof. And our troubleshooter that's sent out to restore the power at that time makes an assessment if it's safe to provide temporary power. And if it is, then they may our process would be that they would leave the tag, talk to the homeowner. If the homeowner's not there, the idea is they leave a tag. But there's follow-up then that occurs through our system and through our processes that would initiate a follow-up inspection to see if the work has been completed and to provide the customer more context. So, and from our pre-conversation, and we're going to follow up with them a little bit more after this, it sounds like some of perhaps the letter that typically provides the details of what we're seeing and what needs to be repaired on the residence or on the building did not make it to the customer in this situation. So what we do is after the letter has been initiated, we provide about 15 days before we go out and reinspect the service to see if the repairs have been made. If they haven't, then we leave a tag again, and a troubleshooter is then sent out to disconnect the power.
And how long were you out of?
1 week.
1 week?
Yes, ma'am.
That's a long time.
My family and I.
And how come that didn't, how come things didn't work a little bit quicker?
So at the point, I believe, after the service was disconnected, then we have to go through the process. Once the service is disconnected, we have to, the customer has to go through the permitting process, and OPPD does not reconnect the electrical service until City of Omaha has made their inspection.
That's incorrect. I mean, as far as in your processing procedure-wise, and it may be temporary, they came back out and connected my power. And my whole premise and all that is, if it's deemed unsafe from the get-go, why did you come back out and reconnect my power? If it's deemed unsafe now, it should be unsafe then. That's my whole principal point. I have a host of other questions as well, but just to argue for that moment, if you don't, why is it that now it's okay temporary to restore my power, but in the future, like I said, 15 days from now, this is the first I've heard this, by the way, 15 days is the time allowed it. Why is it, what's the difference? Tell me, what's the difference?
So as I said, initially, the troubleshooter makes a judgment call on whether they feel it is safe to establish temporary service. Understanding that an electrician needs to be involved and the permitting process needs to take place to establish permanent service or reconnect it in the normal permitted way based on the municipal codes. And so, you know, I think we need to follow up with the details because perhaps there was a misperception or the inspection wasn't consistent with, or the conclusion wasn't consistent. My understanding was that when our troubleshooter went out, it was deemed then at the, I believe it was in October when it was disconnected.
Correct.
At that point, that the permanent corrections had not been made to the system, so it was disconnected. And then it went through the permitting process, electrician was hired, and that's when we reconnected it.
Well, furthermore, to even on that point, you know, your policies and procedures, I didn't see anything that indicated to the customer
30
owner.
Seconds.
Like I said, I have a host of questions. You know, my main concern and chief concern is you guys are putting these at people's doors indicating that, you know, unsafe, do this, that. And then you, as a diligent customer, I do what I'm supposed to do. And I'm still have to suffer from you guys' inability to communicate and foster what your policies and procedures say. I'm very disappointed. My family, I have suffered a major loss because of all of this. And I come at you guys in particular because your strategic directives do not address customers like myself.
Time.
That's 30 seconds. Can I have additional time to voice my complaints? Thank you, sir. Like I said, I'm a customer owner. I'm elected. I vote for you officials as well. I've called and left many messages, and this is the first communication I've heard from you guys. I am very disappointed. I have lost trust in you guys' inability to provide me as customer owner and my family service, reliable service at that, which you state over and over again today at your meetings, and I find that very hard to believe. I find that very hard to believe, and I'm very disgusted, and I hope after this meeting, you're, and also my elected official, which one of you is my elected official?
Time.
Who? Which one?
Where do you live?
4313 Saratoga Street.
Probably me, District 6.
I called and left emails. I had no return phone call of any such. Can you tell me why?
I don't. This is the first time meeting you or hearing of your concerns.
So no, has any other board members heard of my complaints emails that I sent? I've sent various emails to the entire board.
Yes.
Voicing my concerns. I did not receive one phone call.
And we did
no
attempt to reach out. So
no.
As I shared, unless we have, perhaps we have a bad phone number.
That's not it. That's not a libel.
So
excuse me, miss.
We'll
I'm sorry. There's no
that.
Way.
At this point in time,
would you
visit with Ms. Comstock, who's the vice president in charge of this area, and she will report back to us at the next board meeting.
As in, report back as in to?
What happened and why and what corrective measures.
And how to build trust and relations with their customers?
More importantly, if there's anything we can legally and ethically do moving forward to prevent this type of thing from happening again.
No doubt. That's what I'm here for.
Appreciate you bringing it to our attention, sir. Yes. I understand your frustration.
Thank you.
There should be some lessons.
When I understand the other frustration on requiring a licensed electrician to restore this stuff, but that's the municipal code. We don't have any control over.
And I get that as well, but on your environmental stewardship, you guys should be afforded to allow the customer owner. You should be providing some kind of guidance, leadership, indicating to him, hey, there's a code out. There's a energy things. Are you guys providing those to the customers?
That's all in the letter you didn't get.
That's my fault?
No, it's not your fault. I'm just saying that's where the communication breakdown seems to have happened, and I want to find out why that happened. Is the house in a different name? What's going on here? So at least let us find that out.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? No, you've already spoken.
No, I asked questions on the last.
No, topic. You're done. You've already spoken for this time.
Okay.
And no two bites. There's nothing else I'd like to. We'll adjourn the meeting at this time.
Thank you.
Well done, John.